This is the program on constitutional government, and our speaker today is Jason Riley. Jason Riley is a graduate of SUNY Buffalo, comes from Buffalo, and he's never wasted a moment of his life in graduate school. And he's here with us today. He's got a column in the Wall Street Journal, and he's a senior fellow at the Manhattan Institute in New York. He's written a book, came out in 2008, The Case for Open Borders, and he's most recently written a book, which is really the subject of our meeting today, called Please Stop Helping Us, and it's How Liberals Make It Harder for Blacks to Succeed. And so his talk today is on that theme, the welfare state against blacks. So Jason Riley, thank you.
Thank you for that introduction. Professor, can everyone hear me? Is this on? Everyone can hear me okay? So my first book was about immigration, and this one is about race. So clearly I picked the easy subjects, the ones that bring us together as a country and unite us. Yeah, I don't know. Abortion, gay marriage, something like that. But I do, today I want to talk about something that I think does unite us in some extent, something that a lot of people do agree on, and that is that despite a half century of concerted efforts to help the black underclass, things aren't going very well for that group. The black underclass, the black poor, are in pretty bad shape today, despite a half century of efforts, concerted efforts on their behalf in this country. Now the agreement pretty much ends there, but it is a place to start. So let's start with the good news. Last month we celebrated Martin Luther King's birthday, and last year we marked the 50th anniversary of what may be King's greatest achievement, the Voting Rights Act of 1965. The 1964 Civil Rights Act outlawed discrimination based on race and gender, and religion, and gave blacks access to jobs and public spaces that had previously been denied them, but access to the voting booth, access to the ballot, was still, of course, a challenge for blacks, particularly in the South. President Lincoln said, we're a government of the people, by the people, and for the people, but that's only true if all the people can register and vote. The ability to vote is, of course, what protects all the other freedoms we enjoy in this country and how we are able to hold our elected officials responsible. So after the Civil Rights Act passed, Dr. King pressed for a Voting Rights Act, too. And 50 years ago last summer, President Johnson signed it into law. And it's been a remarkable success. Just to give you an idea of how successful the Voting Rights Act has been, in 1964, the year before it passed, just 7% of blacks in the state of Mississippi were registered to vote. 7%. It was the lowest percentage of anywhere in the South. By 1966, just 1 year after the Voting Rights Act passed, the black voter registration rate in Mississippi had climbed to 60%, the highest in the South. And Mississippi wasn't an outlier. In Georgia, it went from 19% to 51% over the same period. In fact, every southern state had striking gains. Today, the black voter registration rate in the South is higher than it is in other parts of the country. And in 2012, the last presidential election, the percentage of blacks who voted was higher than the percentage of whites who voted for the first time in US history. That's how significant the Voting Rights Act has been. Along with the Civil Rights Act, it represented the culmination of a modern-day civil rights movement. And what I wanted to talk about for a few minutes this afternoon is what has happened in the wake of these civil rights gains. what has risen from the ruins of Jim Crow in terms of policies aimed at blacks in general and the black underclass in particular, what's working, what's not working, and how much of what's not working can be blamed on racism. And I think it's a good time to ask those questions, not only because we just marked half century after the Voting Rights Act, but also because we just marked the 50th anniversary of Lyndon Johnson's Great Society programs. Programs that were supposed to help eliminate poverty and reduce racial inequality. Just before signing that Voting Rights Act, Johnson gave a famous speech at Howard University, the historically black college in DC, where he talked about what the government should do next on behalf of blacks. He said the freedom to vote, to hold a job, to go to school, enter a public place was not enough. He said the next and more profound stage of the battle for civil rights was to ensure equal results, equal outcomes. He moved the goalpost from equal opportunity to equal results. But what if Johnson was mistaken? What if there are limits to what government can do beyond removing barriers to freedom? What if the best that we can hope for from our elected officials and policymakers are policies that promote a level playing field? And what if policymakers risk doing even more damage, creating more problems and barriers to progress when the focus is on equal outcomes? I think there are limits, even when the policies are well-intentioned, and I think the past half century is evidence for that. For more than 50 years, the political left in particular has pushed for more government assistance for blacks through racial preferences, forced integration, expanded welfare entitlements, and so forth. Black leaders have urged racial solidarity and prioritized the pursuit of political power. Between 1970 and 2010, the number of black elected officials grew from fewer than 1,500 to more than 10,000, including, of course, a black president. But how has this helped the black underclass? In 2013, Mississippi had more black elected officials than any other state in the country, yet it continues to have one of the highest poverty rates in the country. Over the past half century, the U.S. has spent some $20 trillion after inflation on anti-poverty programs alone. But what do we have to show for it? The official poverty rate in 2012 was higher than it had been in the mid-60s. And the black-white poverty gap has actually widened over the past decade. The racial disparity in incarceration rates is also larger today than it was in 1960. Black unemployment, on average, has been double that of white unemployment for more than five decades. Yes, gains have been made. On balance, blacks are certainly better off today than they were half a century ago. My being here, a product of the black inner city, is proof of that, in my opinion. But the track record regarding the black poor is appalling. It's clear that government programs aren't the solution to many of these problems that the black underclass faces. It's clear that the Great Society programs may be well-intentioned, but are not getting the job done. And the question, of course, is why? I think the short answer is that the focus has been on redistributing wealth to blacks instead of on producing wealth among blacks. The lesson of the past 50 years ought to be that simply transferring cash and benefits, services to the poor, does not necessarily make people more prosperous. I think blacks ultimately have to help themselves, have to develop the same attitudes and habits and behaviors that other groups in America had to develop in order to rise. And to the extent that a government policy, however well-intentioned, interferes with this necessary self-development, I think it's doing more harm than good. Open-ended welfare benefits do not help people develop a work ethic, which is ultimately what they must develop in order to rise out of poverty. Increasing the minimum wage to $15 an hour will increase the cost of hiring younger, less skilled, less experienced workers, many of whom happen to be black. So fewer blacks will wind up getting that first job and the experience that comes with it. Soft on crime laws make ghettos more dangerous for the mostly law-abiding residents who live there. And they make life easier for the criminals who, of course, prey primarily on other blacks, and the black poor in particular, and so on. Yet all of these policies continue to be pushed in the name of helping blacks. And the promoters of the policies don't seem very interested in reevaluating some of the basic assumptions at work here. But I think it's also important to notice, or to note, the progress that was occurring in black America prior to the implementation of many of these programs designed to help them. Programs that often receive all the credit for any progress that we have seen. For example, between 1940 and 1960, the black poverty rate in America fell by 40 percentage points. Think about that. This is before the Civil Rights Act was passed, before the Voting Rights Act was passed. This was during Jim Crow. This was during a period of open, rampant, and legal racial discrimination in this country. A 40 percentage point drop in black poverty. Now, poverty continued to fall after Great Society programs were implemented in the 1960s, but at a much slower rate. At best, the Great Society programs were continuing an existing trend. Yet these programs are given all the credit for any reductions in black poverty that we've seen. The reality is that no Great Society program has ever come close to matching what blacks were doing on their own before that policy had been put in place, before the government decided to intervene and help. The notion that black self-help is more effective than government help is not based on some right-wing, extremist, Koch brothers-funded ideology. It's based on experience. It's based on the historical record. History shows repeatedly that there simply is no substitute for a group's self-development. Government programs cannot save us. And an over-dependence on them, from our experience, can do great, great harm. Affirmative action, racial preferences are another example of a program that gets much more credit than it deserves. In this case, credit for increasing the size of the black middle class in America. But again, what does the record show? Well, it shows that between 1930 and 1970, the percentage of black white-collar workers in America quadrupled. Between 1950 and 1960, in New York City alone, the number of black accountants increased by 220%. The number of engineers grew by 134%. The number of teachers grew by 125%. Physicians and lawyers grew by more than 50%. Nurses increased by 90%, and on and on. That's before affirmative action policies were implemented in the 1970s. That's during a period when you could put a sign in your window that said, "We don't hire blacks." Yet in the face of these obstacles, blacks were entering the skilled professions at unprecedented rates. Yes, blacks continued to enter the white-collar professions in the wake of affirmative action programs. But again, this simply continued an existing trend. There was a substantial black middle class already in existence in this country by the end of the 1960s. It has continued to grow, but at a much slower rate than it was growing before. And as with black poverty reduction, no affirmative action program has ever come close to matching what blacks were doing on their own prior to the implementation of that affirmative action program. Moreover, racial preferences have not helped the poor, as proponents told us they would. Instead, they have worked mostly to help already well-off blacks become better off. There have been case studies, places like Atlanta, for example, in the 1970s and 80s, where under black mayors like Maynard Jackson and Andrew Young, the city implemented racial preference policies for hiring black city workers and contractors. What happened? Well, the number of successful black businesses increased rapidly, but average income blacks were left behind, and the black poor lost ground. And that's been the story of the black poor, not only in Atlanta, but nationwide. In the era of affirmative action, the black underclass has lost ground, both in absolute terms and relative to the white underclass in the country. In the 1970s and 80s, and even into the 90s, the first three full decades of affirmative action policies, the poorest 20% of blacks saw their incomes decline at more than double the rate of comparable whites. Again, the empirical data show that in an era of racial preferences and quotas and set-asides put in place to help the black poor, that subset has regressed. But I would also argue that there is a large cultural component to what is going on here, to the racial disparities that we continue to see today, whether we're talking about employment or education, incarceration, income, or other measures. Yet it's become almost taboo to talk about black cultural problems. Antisocial behavior, attitudes towards work and school and parenting, black kids teasing one another for acting white. I've often told the story, and I tell it in the book, about a trip back home to Buffalo, New York, where I was born and raised. I was visiting my older sister shortly after I'd begun working at the Wall Street Journal, and I was talking to her daughter, my niece, before dinner one evening, just chatting about how things were in school. She was maybe in the second grade at the time. She stops me in the middle of a sentence. She says, "Uncle Jason, why you talk white?" And she turned to her little friend sitting next to her and said, "Don't my uncle sound white? Why are you trying to sound so smart?" Now, they were just teasing, of course, and enjoyed a little chuckle at my expense, but what they said really stayed with me. I couldn't help thinking here were two young black girls, 7 or 8 years old, already linking speech patterns to race and intelligence. They already had a rather sophisticated awareness that as blacks, white-sounding speech was not only to be avoided in their own speech, but mocked in the speech of others. Now, I shouldn't have been too surprised by this, and I wasn't. My siblings, along with countless other black friends and relatives, teased me the same way growing up. And other black professionals, from the president and first lady on down, have told similar stories. It's simply not that uncommon. What I had forgotten is just how early these attitudes start, how soon this antisocial, counterproductive behavior begins. In New York City, where I'm based, largest school system in the country, and 80% of the black kids in New York City public schools are performing below grade level, 80%. And a big part of the problem is a black subculture that rejects attitudes and behaviors that are conducive to academic success. Black kids read half as many books and watch twice as much television as their white counterparts for example. In other words, a big part of the problem is a culture that produces little black girls and boys who are already worried about acting and sounding white by the time they are in the second grade. Another big part of the problem is a reluctance to speak honestly about these issues, these cultural shortcomings. Many whites fear being called racist, and many black leaders have a vested interest in blaming black problems primarily on white racism. So that is the narrative they push, regardless of the reality. Racism has become an all-purpose explanation for bad black outcomes in America, be they social or economic. If you disagree and are white, you're a bigot. If you disagree and are black, you're a sellout. Too often, this is the level of discourse, schoolyard name-calling. Even President Obama has been subjected to this treatment when he broaches the topic of black cultural shortcomings, which he's done on a few occasions. On several occasions, he's spoken to black audiences about absent fathers, for example. When he spoke at Morehouse in Atlanta a couple years ago, he said, "I was raised by a heroic single mother and wonderful grandparents who made incredible sacrifices for me. But I still wish I had a father who was not only present but involved. And so my whole life, I've tried to be for Michelle and my girls what my father wasn't for my mother and me. I've tried to be a better father, a better husband, a better man." Obama told those black men in the audience to be a good role model for other, less fortunate black men. He said, quote, "The brothers who have been left behind, who haven't had the same opportunities we have, they need to hear from us. We need to be in the barbershops with them, at church with them, helping to pull them up, exposing them to new opportunities. We have to teach them what it means to be a man," unquote. Now, that might sound like common sense to you and me. In fact, there are probably some people in this room that wish this is all Obama would ever talk about.
Could you repeat that sentence, please?
It was a joke that didn't land very well. But when Obama says these things out loud in public, he gets slammed by liberals in general and the black left in particular, because he's seen as criticizing black culture, condescending to blacks, being an elitist. Most significantly, he's accused of letting whites off the hook, which is a big no-no on the black left. But the facts are on Obama's side. For decades, studies have shown that the likelihood of teen pregnancy and drug abuse, dropping out of school, many other bad social outcomes increased dramatically when fathers were not around. One of the most comprehensive studies ever done about this concluded that black boys without a father were almost 70% more likely to be incarcerated than those with a father. The social scientist James Q. Wilson put it this way: if crime is to a significant degree caused by weak character, if weak character is more likely among children of unmarried mothers, if there are no fathers who will help raise their children, acquire jobs, protect their neighborhoods, if boys become young men with no preparation for work, if school achievement is regarded as a sign of having sold out, if all these things are true, then the chances of reducing the crime rate among low-income blacks anytime soon is slim. This is what we see playing out today in Baltimore, in St. Louis, in the Bronx, in Brooklyn, in Chicago, in Detroit. But you can't say that out loud. Particularly, and I mean that literally, you whites cannot say that out loud. You can, but you will catch hell. When I say it, I will get my head handed to me. But we all know it's true. The Ku Klux Klan is not driving through these neighborhoods spraying bullets. That is not what is going on. But you can't state the obvious. It is politically incorrect. Try to bring up black culture in a debate about crime today. You'll have your head handed to you. Try to bring up the breakdown of the black family in a debate about incarceration rates. In fact, that's all we talk about today, are incarceration rates. We don't even talk about crime, per se, as if the two are completely unrelated. We talk about police shootings of black men as a measure of whether America values black lives or whether cops value black lives. We have mobs of people all over this country pretending that there's an epidemic of cops shooting blacks. And the media has played right along. This is nonsense. The reality is that police are involved in approximately 2% of black shooting deaths each year in this country. One economist has calculated that a cop is about 6 times as likely to be shot by someone black as the opposite scenario. Blacks are about 13% of the population in this country, but commit more than half of all murders. Roughly 7,000 blacks are murdered each year, and 90% of them are killed by other blacks. There's your epidemic. There's your tragedy. That's the outrage. The question isn't whether cops value black lives or America values black lives. Isn't the more relevant question whether the young black men doing all this killing value black lives? Are we supposed to hold whites to hold higher standards than blacks hold one another? Homicide is the leading cause of death for young black men in the U.S. And it is not because cops are shooting them. Bad cops should be punished to the full extent of the law. And they should certainly be held to a higher standard for violating the public trust. But if you believe that black lives matter, if you want to reduce the black body count, as a practical matter, should the focus be on the 2% of black shooting deaths that involve cops or the 98% that don't? The violence that is so prevalent in these neighborhoods has enormous economic consequences. The common assumption is that poverty causes crime. But the truth is closer to the reverse. Businesses flee crime-ridden neighborhoods. Jobs follow. Property values fall. One reason that blacks were progressing at a much faster rate in the first half of the 20th century is that black communities were much, much less violent than they are today. The violence so prevalent today dates to the policy interventions of the 1960s, when coddling criminals became fashionable among judges, politicians, and academics. And the government mistakenly believed that a welfare check could replace a father in the home. Before 1960, 2 out of 3 black children were raised in two-parent families in this country. Today, more than 70% are not. And in our inner cities, it can reach as high as 80 or 90%. Before 1960, homicide rates in the U.S., including among blacks, had been falling significantly. In fact, the murder rate in 1960 was less than half of what it had been 25 years earlier. Blacks obviously faced much more racism back then. But black families were also in much better shape. And black communities were much safer and thus more conducive to social and economic progress, which is what we saw occurring back then. Let me close by noting that this concept of self-help and self-development that I think is essential to black advancement is something that black leaders once understood in this country, understood it well, and at a time when blacks faced infinitely more obstacles than they face in a country with a twice-elected black president in the Oval Office. Frederick Douglass, a former slave, said in 1865 that everybody had asked him and the other abolitionists what to do with the Negro. He said, "I've had but one answer from the beginning. Do nothing with us. If the apples will not remain on the tree of their own strength, let them fall. And if the Negro cannot stand on his own legs, let him fall also. All I ask is, give him a chance to stand on his own legs." Douglass was essentially saying, give blacks equal opportunity and then leave us alone. Booker T. Washington, another former slave, echoed that sentiment. He said that it is important and right that all privileges of the law be ours, but that it is vastly more important that we be prepared for the exercise of these privileges. Douglass and Washington didn't play down the need for the government to secure equal rights for blacks, and both were optimistic that they would get equal rights eventually, though neither man lived to see that day, of course. But both men also understood the limits of government benevolence. Blacks would have to ready themselves to meet the far bigger challenge of being in a position to take advantage of opportunities once equal rights had been secured. The history of 1960s liberal social policies is largely a history of ignoring this wisdom, I believe. The Obama presidency is more evidence that blacks have indeed progressed politically in this country. But if the rise of other racial and ethnic groups is any indication, black social and economic problems are less about politics than they are about culture. A black man in the White House is all well and good, but he cannot substitute for one in the home. On that happy note, I will stop and take any questions if you have them. Thank you.
Yes, Rory.
Thank you for your talk. I'm white, so this is going to be on YouTube, so I have to choose my words carefully. I'm a minority. I'm from Canada, so you can't tell. My speech pattern gives it away slightly. I wanted to ask you kind of about the issue of the welfare state and your argument. I guess that was sort of your argument. I mean, a lot of the arguments that you could critique the welfare state's relation to the African-American community can be applied to many other communities. You could show that the welfare state maybe impacts Appalachian white poor badly or Hispanic poor in Arizona or whatever. And, you know, it would vary in different circumstances, but, you know, it might be persuasive across all kinds of different impoverished groups, disadvantaged groups. And so that, I guess, then it would lead to wonder what its effect in particular on blacks. And again, if it has a more severely negative effect on blacks, you could say that that's because of blacks' greater vulnerability or impoverishment in the United States. Sort of like an incompetent hospital, if it has a badly functioning emergency room, that's going to cause greater harm than a badly functioning urology department, but it could be the same kind of general dysfunction. Public hospital, whatever. So what, is there a sense in which there are particular aspects of the so-called welfare state agenda that are particularly bad for blacks? The one that came up a lot, I think, was incarceration, which we don't tend to think of as a welfare state policy, either being for mandatory sentencing or against it, and so quote unquote soft on crime. Are there parts of the welfare state agenda that are specific to the status of blacks in the United States and not simply a general public policy question? Because it just seems that, in a way, this whole... I just guess that there's a lot of racism in America that a lot of whites don't like blacks, and the welfare state might be doubling down on the damage that does, but it might not be really anything to do with the welfare state. It might be the welfare state making a bad situation worse.
I think it is making a bad situation worse. I mean, I think the great society programs have impacted different groups differently, but on balance, for most groups, racial and ethnic groups, the safety net has been temporary help when you hit hard times. What we've seen among a disproportionate number of blacks is a generational cycle of welfare dependency. It has not been a temporary well station, way station where you get back on your feet and then move off again. So it has impacted different groups differently. And certain policies are going to impact different groups differently because we're not widgets. We're not all interchangeable. Black population is generally younger than the white population. So it's the Hispanic population in general that's going to have a completely different effect on how, for instance, raising minimum wages will impact labor force participation rates. If a disproportionate number of your group is younger, they're going to be disproportionately affected by a wage floor and who gets hired at that age. So there are, yes, the welfare state is impacted different groups differently. I think I'd like to see more of a focus on what was happening in Black America prior to the welfare state. And that's why I spent so much time talking about what was going on in between, say, Reconstruction and the Civil Rights Movement that began in earnest in the 1950s. And the progress we saw at that period is not something that current civil rights establishment wants to put much focus on. And I think the reason is it makes them less relevant to these debates if in fact fundamental civil rights issues are no longer the issue. If in fact this is a matter of self-development, they're continuing to place the focus on what whites should be doing for blacks instead of what blacks should be doing for themselves sounds more and more silly. So I don't think they have much interest in exploring or highlighting this history that I'm talking about in the first half of the 20th century. But to me, it shows what could be done in the face of tremendous amount of discrimination and what was, in fact, happening. And so I think the biggest problem with the welfare state are the incentives that have been put in place. I spoke about trying to replace a breadwinner with a government check and so forth. So it's problems on that regard too. I'll leave it there.
Yes.
Thanks so much for especially I like your focus on this around the Great Society program, the trend is sort of things were going okay, but the Great Society program really sort of gave a break. And I have two questions. The first, what do the black leaders, especially on the left, think about this data? What do they think that the do they deny that the data, or if they accept the data, that they think a Great Society program did not do enough or didn't do right? And that's the first question. Second question, what do you think should be done then? We cannot withdraw Great Society program, that spirit, at this moment politically. It's next impossible, so I'm wondering what you think of it.
Well, the first question as to what the current black leadership thinks of the data, I think they dismiss it or downplay its significance because they have an entirely different agenda that they're pushing, and that data undermines their agenda.
But they have to say something facing the data. No. They don't have to.
No. There are many explanations for what was going on in the country in the first half of the 20th century. I mean, part of what was going on was the post-World War II economy. America was booming, and blacks were participating in that. It was lifting all boats, so to speak. Blacks were migrating out of the South at the time, doing the same job in Detroit that you were doing in Mobile, Alabama is going to pay a lot more in Detroit, even if it's the same job. So they were lifting their earnings simply by moving geographically to a different part of the country. They were increasing their years of education, again, both in absolute terms and relative to whites, which was, again, going to increase your compensation. So there are a lot of things going on at the time. There are a lot of explanations for these. But the civil rights establishment's focus is white racism. They're operating, you know, when you go back to leaders like a Dr. King, people of that period, the NAACP at that time, they brought a mentality to this that said blacks will have to succeed in America notwithstanding racism. We've just got to get our act together and plow ahead. The civil rights establishment's attitude today is the complete reverse of that. Don't expect blacks to succeed or move ahead or close any kind of racial gaps until racism has been vanquished from America. So they set about looking for, you know, Confederate flag sightings. Oh, look, see? Don't talk to me about those incarceration rates when we got people waving the Confederate flag around. That's their, it's the complete opposite. And so they latch on to any signs of residual racism, again, as an all-purpose explanation for all of these racial disparities we see. And so that's where they keep the focus. And this data from the earlier period of the 20th century is not something they are going to highlight, and to the extent that they can downplay it or ignore it, they will. I mean, the civil rights movement has become a civil rights industry, and it is tremendously lucrative. The racial grievance industry in this country is alive and well. You can make a very good living spending all of your time searching out white racism and highlighting as an explanation for all the bad things you see going on in Black America. You can still make a very, very good living doing that's what they do.
I lived in a small town in the South back in the 70s. My daughter attended the high school, 50% white and 50% black. This was Macon, Georgia. And there were no problems, no knives, no drugs. He came back with a Southern accent.
What year would this have been?
1979. No drugs, no knives. She came back with a Southern accent after a while. Yeah. My wife thought maybe it was time to move back north. But there was a reason for that. The families were intact, and they were in charge of the young people. Both the white families and the black families. And religion was still very strong. So I'd be interested in your take on what's going on in the South. You have the political reverends like Al Sharpton getting the media attention, getting the legitimacy at the expense of the conservative black ministry. Is this eroding, along with the welfare programs, seeping into other southern cities, the smaller cities, not just Atlanta?
Is what eroding?
The erosion of the family and the erosion of effective social control over young people, the breakdown of the family, the welfare system moving into the South and into the
Oh places, yeah, I think so.
Along with most, the politicization of the ministry.
Most blacks still live in the South, in the country. And yes, when I talk about some of our inner cities and the problems we see, yes, you can talk about Chicago and Detroit and Cleveland, but yeah, Atlanta and St. Louis are also involved in that. Houston, you see the same sort of social pathology, the same sort of problems in these communities. I think it's cultural; it's not necessarily geographic. I will say though, you've seen a reverse migration over the past 20, 25 years of blacks moving back to the South, which I think would, again, undermine the racism narrative that racism is driving all this. If the South was still the South of, Bull Connor, I don't think you'd still, you'd have that migration back south that we've seen. And it wasn't just blacks moving back south. The southeast and the southwest in particular throughout the 90s and 2000s were net plus in population gains. That's where jobs were. That's where people were moving. And blacks were moving right along with the others. So I think that to me is evidence of some racial progress that we've had that, again, the civil rights leadership would want to play down because, again, they have a vested interest in pretending that, Bull Connor is running the St. Louis Police Department, in fact, and Baltimore Police Department, in fact, and so forth.
Yes.
Louis. A bit more about what your positive recommendation for the future would be, because as the questioner before last said, it would be difficult to roll back some of these programs.
It would be difficult, I think, and that's why, my book is not one of solutions. I don't have the solution. I should have made that very clear. I don't have the solutions to the problems I'm addressing. I see my role in looking at public policies, their track record, and starting conversations about what's worked and what hasn't. And I think the people who do claim to have the solutions, I think I'm serving a useful purpose as they proceed to come up with what they think will work. I'd like to see a little more humility on their part instead of a simple doubling down on what's been tried with throwing more resources at the problem. In terms of the Great Society, you're right. It will be very, very difficult to roll back some of these programs. I think we can simply stop growing them to some extent and give people. I think the welfare reforms of 1996 under Clinton did some good. I think there's a template there to work from. Welfare to work programs and stopping open-ended welfare policies and so forth, and I think there's progress there. I'm optimistic on what I see on the education reform front with charter schools, which to me show that these kids are educable and that it is not the kids, it's the schools. You see some of these high-performing charters taking these inner-city kids and producing better test results than you see in white suburbs. It's difficult to expand these models because the powers that be who control them are standing in the way of that. They have different priorities, I think, for the teachers' unions and their political patrons on the left. Public education is more of a jobs program for adults, and so bad schools stay open because they may be failing the kids, but they're still providing jobs. And so we've got to get over that hurdle. But I am optimistic that we have a bunch of education models that we know work for the toughest to teach kids. And it's just really a matter of expanding those models, not coming up with the models. So I think I see progress on that front. But even there, you'll have pushback. I'll give you a good example. Again, from people who want to help, who say this will help. You have the Obama administration pushing public schools to stop suspending black kids as often as they do. How does it help the kids who go to school to learn if you go easy on the bullies? Particularly the black kids who go to school to learn. They're already relegated to the worst schools in the system with the least capable teachers. You're going to make them attend the most violent schools as well? How is this going to help close the achievement gap? And why would you expect to see racial parity in school suspension rates? Why would you expect to see racial parity in disciplinary outcomes in schools? Do you see it outside of schools? Do you think this bad behavior starts after graduation? So the whole basic assumption here that we would see racial parity in outcomes in disciplining kids in school. White kids are suspended at higher rates than Asian kids. Is there an anti-white bias? Boys are suspended at higher rates than girls. I mean, groups behave differently. But why are our sympathies with the bullies and not with the kids who go to school to learn? But that is the mentality. You have the president trying to shut down a school voucher program in Louisiana because it will disrupt desegregation orders from the 1960s and 70s. It'll disrupt the racial balance of the classrooms if this voucher program is allowed to take effect, depending on who takes advantage of the voucher, which families. So the president is essentially more interested in the racial makeup of the classroom than he is in whether anyone's learning. It's all about these priorities and these assumptions that we have. Some of the best public schools in this country are charter schools that are highly segregated. It seems not to have a huge impact on the performance of the kids. Black kids do not need to be sitting next to white kids to learn. It may be nice aesthetically, it might be pleasing to the eye, but to make it a priority, to stop an education reform based on that, where's the evidence? Where is the evidence?
Here's a question. Regardless of what the government should do, what do you think should be the attitude of whites toward blacks? you say stop helping us, and if only it were true about white racism, then that might be better
for
you.
No, it's not your fight. it's not your struggle. It's not your fight. You're welcome to join the conversation, but it's not really about you. Blacks need to have these conversations with other blacks in these communities. And these conversations are taking place. Some blacks don't want to have them in front of any white people. But I guess one I've heard other black conservatives say this, they could do with fewer guilt trips. I mean, a lot of these efforts to help, regardless of whether any it's helping, has to do with alleviating the guilt of the person trying to help. And so while they may be making themselves feel better, they're not doing any good, and in some cases are doing harm. You take something like affirmative action in higher education. Sympathetic whites, kids from difficult backgrounds, let's let them into the schools, cut the corner, let them in, it'll all work out in the end. No, it doesn't all work out in the end. It doesn't all work out in the end. You're mismatching kids with schools, you're setting up smart black kids to fail at institutions that you want them to be in because it's aesthetically pleasing, instead of letting them into, let the chips fall where they may, letting them attend schools where they can meet the requirements of the average freshman at that school and have a much greater chance of succeeding at that school and graduating? I mean, what is the priority here? I was talking last night to someone and brought up a study done some years ago of black kids at MIT. Black kids at MIT in this study scored in the top 10% on the math section of the SAT. All kids in the country, top 10%. Talking about some really smart black kids. But they were in the bottom 10% among their peers at MIT. So kids who would be hitting it out of the park at a less selective school were struggling and failing at higher rates, switching to easier majors at MIT. But the administrators at MIT, their priority was making that college catalog look like America, making that campus, color coding that campus, diversity. Whether or not you graduated was a secondary concern. How are you helping? Out in the University of California system after they ended racial preferences back in the 1990s, black college graduation rates went up by more than 50%, including in some of the more difficult disciplines of math and science and engineering. Again, by more than 50%, a program that had been put in place to increase the ranks of the black middle class, increase the number of black doctors and lawyers, was in fact producing fewer black doctors and lawyers and engineers and chemists than we would have had in the absence of the policy. Stop helping. I mean, that's the point. I mean, so I think ultimately that this is a an issue that the black community is going to have to work out on its own. I don't think it's going to come from the black political leadership, by the way, because, again, I think they have their own agenda, like the civil rights leaders do, and they're not necessarily the same agenda that that the black underclass needs pushed on their behalf. So I don't think it's going to come from the black political leadership either. But it is something that I think will have to come from the black community, and whether that's going to be led by, you know, just community activists or ministers or what have you, but people close to the ground. And these organizations do exist. Many of you don't know about them, though, because the press runs to Jesse Jackson, Al Sharpton, speak on behalf of the black community. And so that's who you hear about. But there are people in these communities doing this work and saying these things out loud. They just don't have their own TV shows or meet with Obama in the White House.
Roger.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. Thank you for an excellent talk, helping me understand this whole America's original sin much more clearly than before. Very early in your talk, you referred quite a bit to the voting rights question. And of course, there's a tremendous amount of controversy in the Supreme Court area and the whole judicial system, as well as in the Congress about voting rights issues and what we do to continue the progress made in that area. At the present time, I wonder if there's so many complications there that I'm
I don't think
so
it's
confused.
Complicated at all, and that's why I started with the Voting Rights Act. I think it's very clear. It's been a tremendous success. And this debate we're having over voter ID laws and the rest, the voter ID laws were put in place prior to 2012. And yet, you had blacks out turning out at higher rates than whites for elections, even in states with the toughest voter ID laws. Even in southern states with the toughest voter ID laws, the black voter turnout rate was higher than the white turnout rate. This whole discussion over voting rights and whether the black franchise is there, it's a complete, pure political debate aimed at ginning up black people and Democrats using it to rile up their base. The black franchise is not in jeopardy. Blacks are turning out for elections at unprecedented rates. Nothing decided by the Supreme Court does anything to jeopardize the Voting Rights Act's core. And, you know, if a black person or any other person feels that they are being denied the right to vote or access to a ballot, they have legal recourse. So I think it is a non-issue. The black franchise is not in jeopardy in this country, and the proliferation of voter ID laws is not evidence to the contrary. I think it is evidence that people are worried about ballot integrity, but the left wants to turn it into purely this effort by evil Republicans to strip away black people's right to vote. And I don't think they have the evidence on their side, given these black voter turnout rates that we've seen. And again, they predate Obama. This is a trend that dates back to the Clinton administration, this increase in black voter turnout.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yes, Alex.
So one slightly peculiar aspect of the situation that you describe it is that when blacks were still oppressed and mistreated by whites in the 40s and 50s, the prevailing norm in the black community seems to have been to imitate whites. And I have some anecdotal evidence for this because a friend of mine, black, was born in 1940, has described this and says that when he was growing up, the norm was to imitate whites, and he's somewhat perplexed by what happened.
By imitate, do you mean assimilate?
Okay, assimilate is a better, yeah, that's a better term. Follow the norms of
yeah,
white
I
society.
Think, yeah, I think, yes, I think so, integration and, or prior to the movement towards integration, there was always assimilation taking place. But you also always had black separatists out there, even prior to the 1960s when they really
So that was real,
came to
that
the fore.
The,
yeah.
The gist of my question. In the 60s, you had the Great Society program. You also had the growth of
Black separatism.
Black separatism,
yeah.
Which you haven't really discussed as a theme.
No, I think it's an unfortunate development. I think that the Black left and the King coalition was really broken up by these Black separatism groups like Jewish Americans who had been allies of the civil rights movement for decades, there from the beginning, starting in NAACP and so forth, broke with the civil rights movement over the anti-Semitism of the Black separatist movement. So I think a lot of longtime alliances were destroyed to the detriment of and the credibility of the civil rights movement. Again, this shift from equal opportunity to equal results, the move towards quotas and set-asides. I think a lot of Jews looked at that and said, we cannot go there. We've been there, and we're not going back to that. And we can't be behind you pushing for something like that. We were for equal opportunity. You've moved the goalpost here. And I think the Black left is worse off because they decided to go that route. They lost moral credibility, and they lost a lot of allies that had been with them for a long time.
But is that linked to attitudes that you reported, for example, amongst your niece? Like the cultural
is what linked
the Black separatism and then attitude?
Yeah, I think it is. I think it is. Racial solidarity, this sort of reflexive rejection of the man and anything he stands for, and not just in how we're going to dress, but how we're going to talk. And then you see how this becomes self-defeating. Ebonics. Attitudes towards work and school. Yes, and a complete reversal from what earlier generations of Blacks thought about these things. I think there is some connection there.
Thank you so much for being here. I always look forward to your columns in the journal. And even though I'm not in charge, I would certainly recommend you being a graduation speaker here. At, your message would have
Thank
a tremendous impact on changing people's minds. So I had a couple of questions, or a couple of thoughts that are combining some of the things you said about higher education and culture. And I can say this because I'm an Asian, but I'm probably told every few months something that would trigger a national disgrace in terms of a racist remark. I mean, by people here at Harvard, I'm in the physics department, like, oh, you're not really Asian, you're really just white. And, you know, oh, where are you from? Oh, your English is really good. Like, well, I was born in Ohio,
yeah.
Right? And this is routinely, but I just don't care, right? Like, if you say that, it just proves that you don't know anything, right? Like, it's not like I'm going to take this to a lawsuit. But now, like, I think pushing forward in terms of, like in terms of culture, as a physicist, I'm just not persuaded that anybody really cares about my personal culture, what my family background is, and it's just not that important in how we interact. And you sort of see this with affirmative action in higher education, say beyond the college level, say in the STEM fields or in the Silicon Valley. There's this move that there should basically be lowered requirements, and yet it's the most meritocratic, most aggressive thing. And it just seems a complete mismatch where you're with these libertarians who essentially are, you know, most of us, there's not even very many American-born whites, right? Most of the people are large, but they're foreigners. Yeah, and only 40% of our engineering school post-PhDs are from America. So this sort of reparation against these people from India,
you're describing perfectly, I think, the future of the affirmative action debate, which is up until now been mostly about whites, Blacks, and Hispanics. Asians, as their numbers grow, are, I think you're going to see more backlash here. It started out in California. Even after the ban on racial preferences in higher education that California implemented back in the 90s, we saw something that many of us suspected was going on, but now we had the proof, which is once schools couldn't take race into account, Asian enrollment at the elite campuses spiked. Now, they all say, we don't have a cap, Caltech, but we don't have a cap, we don't have a cap. But what happened? Asian enrollment spiked, showing that, in fact, they had been artificially capping the number. And at these elite schools, it is a zero-sum game. There are only so many freshman seats at the University of Texas at Austin. And slots saved or put aside for blacks and Hispanics are slots that can't go to other groups. And so the what are the proponents of affirmative action trying to reconcile? They're trying to reconcile equal opportunity for individuals with group preferences, two irreconcilable things. But they also now have to explain why Asians should be disadvantaged because of what explain why Asians should be disadvantaged because of what whites did to blacks. That's where we're going. And these, you have a few lawsuits. I think Harvard's part of one of them. The next fight, you know, the affirmative action for the lawyers in the room will know that the affirmative action fights are usually over the Equal Protection Clause. But now there are some suits winding their way through the courts that are going to use Title VI of the Civil Rights Act, which basically says if you're an institution that accepts federal money, you can't be discriminating by race or taking race into an account, which means even private institutions cannot have these affirmative action policies. That's the argument that these latest lawsuits are bringing to the court. And Asians are the plaintiffs in these suits. So we'll see where it heads. But I think that is going to be largely the future of the affirmative action debate. You're going to see more Asian voices. And there was a move in California. Jerry Brown came into office. He had the supermajority in the Assembly and the Senate. He started grabbing everything off the shelf. He's going to try and ram through. And one thing he wanted to try and do was reverse the referendum in 96 that ended race-based admissions in college admissions at the University of California system. He tried to get his supermajority legislature to pass this. Asian lawmakers stopped this effort. They said, oh, no. We are not going back to this old system. They stopped it cold. And I don't think that's the only place they're gonna raise their hand there and push back.
And how does a college do admissions considering all these factors if the federal government's gonna regulate it? I mean, I have no idea, right? They look at holistically what is the strength.
Well, you
of
need
this?
The Supreme Court to stop punting on the issue. I mean, the Supreme Court keeps saying you can discriminate as long as you're not too obvious about it. No. Use holistic admissions. Schools are either going to stop using standardized tests altogether, or the Supreme Court is going to rule on this. I mean, they were obviously supposed to rule this session. I don't know what's going to happen now because what probably at most would have been a 5-4 vote is now 4-4. So we'll see, but. I think you're right. I think you are describing the future of the affirmative action debate in this country.
Yeah,
it's also, by the way, the other point I wanted to make about Asian groups that relates to what I was saying earlier about a focus on political power, which is something the civil rights movement did back in the 60s. It was a conscious effort. We are going to focus on. I mean, part of the thinking with the Voting Rights Act was that it would lead to more black elected officials. It wasn't just about right access to the ballot. The goal was to increase the number of black elected officials. That political power would then redound to the black underclass and help lift them up. That's why I included those figures on the number of black elected officials we now have in this country. It was successful in that regard. We do have a lot of blacks. Black people have a lot of political clout in this country, but it has not redounded to the black underclass. And again, there are people who have studied this and said we should never have expected it to. Most other groups in this country did it in the reverse. They lifted themselves socioeconomically first. They worried about elected office later. And those groups that did the reverse, like say the Irish, who had these political machines running, your Philadelphias and your Bostons and your New Yorks at the turn of the 20th century, those groups rose slower than groups who went with economic advancement first. And I think Asians are the latest example of this. Group hitting it out of the park in terms of household incomes, representation in the professions, educational attainment. How much political clout do Asians have in America? and has it been a barrier to their progress? And again, I think that's just the latest example that going the political route was the wrong way to go, fundamentally, a fundamental misstep by the civil rights movement. And that continues to be pushed by civil rights leaders today, this focus on political advancement.
The lady, and then you, Ross, and then you.
Yes, I'm Vice Chair Park. I was wondering, did you think that No Child Left Behind helped, that it was supposed to help address black underachievement?
I think it helped in some ways. And the most important way I think it helped is that it forced, and this might get into the weeds for some people, but what schools used to be able to do, districts used to be able to do, is just to report average test scores to the superiors, to the state, and then to the federal government, which meant you didn't know who was lagging behind. If you had, it was easier to rig the numbers. What No Child Left Behind forced these districts and schools to do is to disaggregate the data by race and economics and in terms of and earnings, income. And so we knew. You couldn't hide the fact that you might have a school that's 80% white and 20% black, but you couldn't just send in the average test scores. You had to send in how the white kids are doing and how the black kids are doing on their own. And I think, and the goal originally was that would embarrass schools into trying harder to lift up. You'd be penalized if you weren't making advancement, but even more importantly, you'd just be embarrassed that you had to report this now, so you'd have an incentive to help these underachieving kids. So to the extent that it forced schools to do that, and more of the country got to see what schools had been up to in terms of just reporting these averages, I think it did do some good. It got tied into these other debates over local control later on, but I did like that aspect of it, yes. And so did, by the way, a lot of civil rights organizations, which is why they defended the law. Some of the more reform-oriented civil rights organizations defended the law on those grounds in particular. Yeah.
Go.
Some people who say study totalitarian societies have argued that after the end of communism, for example, there's an unexpected hangover of decline of morality, because the dictator had squashed civil society and personal morality in favor of depending on the government and so on. I wonder, is there a ray of hope here in the parallel to your cultural analysis, which is fairly bleak? Could there be, even in the remark of your niece, a hangover factor that the self-defeat or the self-denigration is an internalizing of family history from the past and can be expected to pass and decline?
I hope so. I should say, in relation to my niece and how that turned out, it turned out fine. She now has a graduate degree. She's better educated than I am. Now I go to her, now who's acting white. She turned out fine. You may be right. I don't know. It's complicated. A lot of what makes this country so unique and is not just the differences in the political system to the totalitarian regimes you're talking about. It's just the diversity of people here and the cultures and the mix that we have here. And you've got a lot of things going on at once in that regard. And what I mean is, while we still have these racial gaps, we also elected a black president twice. So it's proof that progress has been made in terms of attitudes towards blacks by the larger white society on some fronts, but even that change in attitude has not necessarily addressed some of these racial, these social pathologies taking place in these ghetto neighborhoods. Now, some people would say that would never expect the two to be that related to one another in the first place. But as far as a hangover, I think some of the more disturbing data I've seen that we'll be dealing with post-Obama is the decline in race relations on his watch. We've got a lot of ground to make up. I mean, we lost a tremendous amount of ground in this country on that front, if you look at the polling on race relations over the past 8 years, which is sad, but it's true. So it's a sort of multi-front war that we're fighting on behalf of the black underclass. You have victories here, you have setbacks there, but I'm not that pessimistic about it. I mean, I think we'll meddle through.
Thank you for the presentation, but more for your courage. Every time I read you or see you, I can imagine the abuse you take from the black and liberal establishment communities. You educate people, and there are some other courageous people out there like Shelby Steele and others who've been doing this. The facts have been out there for a long time. Mm-hmm. They don't seem to be sinking through. I mean, I spent a long time in the media, and the media just love to play the race story. They love the white versus black and the oppression thing. I was going to ask you whether what we need to change and how we can approach it differently so that there's a different outcome, but you've already said you don't have solutions. So I just wanted to ask, are you optimistic at all?
Well, I think that you mentioned the media, and I think the media could play a role in seeking out voices other than Al Sharpton and Jesse Jackson and the NAACP to speak on behalf of what's going on in black communities. I think that would be a very useful thing for the media to do. And part of the reason they don't do it, I think, is partly just laziness. You've been going to the same people forever. You know, America knows who these people are. It's just it's easy. It's easy. And that's the second thing. The second thing, I think, is that you have a media that politically overwhelmingly agrees with the Jesse Jackson, the Al Sharpton, so they go to them as well. But I think, so I think there is a role. And we have seen over the past 20, 25 years a proliferation of media outlets with different points of view. So, you know, there's some optimism there, I think.
Bobby.
You mentioned earlier that race relations had declined under the very administration where a lot of people are optimistic that race relations would get better. I know people who voted for Obama at least the first time, not because they agreed with him, but because they thought that there would be an advancement in racial relations with a black person. Yeah. Why did it go the wrong way, and what's to be done about it?
What's to be done about it? I don't know. I think you just have to have someone in the White House that can de-escalate these things and not.
Why did Obama not do that?
Well, I think there are a couple things that happened. Some things completely out of the control of the president. I mean, the president's not responsible for Ferguson, Missouri, and what took place there. But he is responsible for how he responded to it and whether he escalated or de-escalated. But other things he's done, I think, contribute to the retrogression in race relations, such as the voting rights stuff we were talking about earlier. This is a president who sent his attorney general, his black attorney general, around the country telling people that Republicans were trying to disenfranchise black people. That is not helping race relations, and he did that. This is a president who sent his attorney general out and others out, his vice president out, to say that criticism of the president is race-based. that is not helpful. So there are things outside of the president's control, I think, that have led to the deterioration in race relations, but there are other things, I think, fully within his control, consciously done, because with a mind towards getting out his base to help his party. And he knows that he knows how to rile up black folks. And playing the race card and keeping that front and center is a good way to do it. You know, Bernie Sanders just runs around now saying, you know, he's always sure to include, you know, systemic racism in every speech. It's a guaranteed applause line if he's in front of a black audience. It's you play to the victim status of blacks, and that's how you earn their vote. That's how you earn their support. And the president has not been above doing that. He has not been above doing that. I think we, to your last question of what's to be done going forward, I think you start with the president who's above that sort of thing. This president has not been.
Jordan.
I want to ask you about Ta-Nehisi Coates and about some of the contributions that he's made to what I think is a sort of similarity between your work, which is to critique government policies, which he's done a pretty good job at, FHA redlining, different criminal justice policies, things like that. I'm curious about a reaction to that work that he's done and maybe how you guys have taken sort of different avenues in that critique. I'm also curious about a second thing related to him, and that is this narrative that he presents in his most recent book about the black body and about the sort of perpetual endangerment of the black male in American society, and what your thoughts are on that, the way in which he presents that idea.
Well, to your first point, I would agree that he does a very good job of laying out all of the efforts made by the government on behalf of blacks and black underclass in particular over the past 50 years, and what an utter failure they've been. He talks about Fair Housing Act, he talks about any number of great society programs. I think it's an excellent analysis of how they haven't worked. Then he concludes by saying, but we need one more, and this one will work. So he goes, his reparations piece, which I read, again, goes through all of these wealth redistribution schemes that have failed. And then he ends the piece by calling for yet another wealth redistribution scheme, reparations. And my question is simply, why are you confident that this one will be any more successful than the ones you've just described for the past, you know, 10,000 words? I don't have an answer to that, but he has this abiding belief that the government can fix black America. And I don't think that is true. And I don't see anything in black America's history that would give them any confidence that the government's often been the source of their problems. And they've had to overcome the government policies that have been put in place that Coates has described so eloquently. So there seems to be a disconnect there as I read his policy analysis. In terms of the black body stuff, I think it's sort of just an over-the-top writing. And it's disconnected from reality. I mean, I grew up, I know something about being black and male in the inner city. It's not that hard to avoid getting shot by cops. It isn't. It's much harder to avoid getting shot by other young black men. And Coates knows that. So to pretend that if his body is in danger, that it's in danger from the police, it's just this whole notion, this whole idea that tension between the cops and the black community, and this lack of trust. Black people call the cops more than any other group in America, which is a funny way of showing you don't trust them. The cops are in these communities because that is where the 9/11 calls originate. That's your explanation. And it is the law-abiding blacks in these communities that the cops are there trying to defend from the black lawmakers, lawbreakers. And that's yeah, that's a fun. Sometimes they're one and the same, yeah. But Coates, it's just this. I he loses me completely on that front. That he just loses me. I don't know what he's.
This was a question about a book. Does everybody know the title of the book? All right, because I've forgotten it. What is it?
That's probably best.
All right.
But Coates is also evidence that the racial grievance industry is alive and well in this country, and that you can still make a very good living blaming black problems on white people. I mean, he's going to pick up right where, you know, the... And he's got a, you know, there are an army of those guys out there. You on the left, you've got, you know, other black academics backing him up. You know, your Michael Eric Dysons, your Jelani Cobbs. It's a whole farm team that the left has out there, sort of intellectualizing Al Sharpton, and that's what they do. But monetizing white guilt. And you can still make a very good living doing that, if that's the route. Much better living, I think, than you can make talking about black self-help. But I still get accused of saying what I say for the money. And I go, well, if I say what I say for the money, you should compare my speaking fees with Ta-Nehisi Coates's and get back to me on that. But
Is that directed against us? No. Right. Anyway, Jason Riley, we're very grateful for your wonderful remarks.
One last one.
There's another question?
Yeah.
Just real quick, on a sort of different topic about the future of race, and in particular, mixing of races, right? Uh-huh. And how these groups, as far as I can tell, are starting to blur. And also, and this is something that I've read more than I've experienced, that African Americans tend to have lower, African American women are not as interested in dating or intermarrying with other. Read and I didn't have any experience with this, but just kind of curious, sort of going forward, as all these boundaries with intermarriage start to blur.
I don't know the numbers. I don't have the numbers at the ready. I do know that black women are very reluctant to marry out. The saying is that they'll marry down before they marry out. So you have a lot of better educated women married to less educated men. I don't know why. I don't know the psychological or sociological research behind it, but I do know it is the case. In terms of intermarriage numbers, though, I just don't know the numbers. But I think that is, if that's what it's going to take a long time. Yeah. I mean, intermarriage rates for other groups are much, much higher. I mean,
Asians,
Hispanics, Jews, people marrying out. Yeah, it's much higher among other groups. Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Jason.
Thank you.